this week, the Stoic Rover crew has come to Pinewood Film Studios in dark East Buckinghamshire to talk to one of the producers of the latest James Bond movie, Octopussy. Now, it's just about coming up to lunchtime, so if we play our cards right, we might be able to get on the set. So let's go see if we can find him. Well, Michael Wilson, you're executive producer on this latest Bond movie, Octopussy. The first question I'd like to ask you is, what does the job of executive producer actually involve?
Well, I think it's really a question of what does the job producer involve, because the executive producer is generally an extension of some job that the producer does. All the producer type of credits are always very vague. Some producers are promoters. They put together packages. In that sense, they might just be sort of super agents for putting films together. Other producers are what they call sort of floor producers. They are in charge of just mechanically getting everything functioning. On our particular film, the production staff is Cubby Broccoli, who's the producer. I'm the executive producer. And we have an associate producer who is in charge of scheduling and the day-to-day running and affairs. The Cubby Broccoli is a different kind of producer, much more the sort of old-fashioned type of independent producer, what they call artistic producers.
Yeah.
That means he gets involved in the writing, the casting, the selection of all the key employees, and he's on from the first time the idea is conceived, and you follow it all the way through pre-production, production, post-production, and then you actually are involved in the supervision of the distribution. And it just so happens that he and I more or less work together doing generally the same thing. Our picture is so big that during the course of production, there's lots of, we have up to 4 or 5 units sometimes working. So two of us are just barely enough to kind of keep general supervision.
Now, you're not only involved in the business side of this film, you also had a hand in the creative aspect in that you've co-written the screenplay. When did you actually start work on the draft screenplay?
We started working on the draft about November of last year.
Yeah.
So maybe September, October, November, around that period of time. We're kicking around a lot of different ideas.
And is that the first work that's done on a James Bond movie?
Yeah, it takes almost 2 years from the time you think about starting to come up with some ideas on the story and the plot line to when you finally get it out to the cinemas. It takes about 2 years.
Is there a committee, if you like, who decide what's going to be in a Bond film?
Generally, Cubby Broccoli and myself think about sort of basic ideas, and then I sit down and work with a writer and take it to a certain stage. Then we bring the director in, and the director then is involved in the writing process as well. I think that's very important that the producer and the director and the writers work very closely with one another, because it means that we're all have a similar vision of what the film's about and a similar idea of how the film is going to be seen and produced and directed, so that we don't have too much difficulty planning it, budgeting it, and the director does not have too much difficulty in visualizing what we're going to be doing. So he can work pretty much with a lot of confidence that he's doing what we all want him to do.
Now, this is by no means your first Bond movie. You also worked on Moonraker and For Your Eyes Only. I'd like to start with Moonraker. Did that film turn out the way you originally intended it at your first production meeting?
Well, I was happy with it.
Yeah.
But you asked the question as though you...
I felt it was, if anything, slightly over the top, if that's possible with a Bond movie. What would your comment on that be?
Well, I thought that after we finished the film and I saw it, I said, well, I think we've kind of gone in that direction. about as far as we can go. So instead of trying to top ourselves by, you know, taking James Bond to Mars or something, we'll have to go sort of in a different direction. Moonraker was an extension of that idea, in the sense of that direction, really.
The budget for Moonraker, I understand, was something in excess of $30 million. So was the decision to make For Your Eyes Only, if you like, a straight thriller, a budgetary one, as well as a creative one in the way that you've just outlined?
Well, I don't think it was so much budgetary, because For Your Eyes Only did cost less, it was only marginally less.
Now, to say that the ski sequence in For Your Eyes Only was action-packed would be something of an understatement. Now, the director of principal photography on that film was John Glenn. Did he actually have a hand in shooting that sequence?
Much, much so, yes. He has a hand in creating all the action sequences and a lot of, you know, the other parts of the film as well. He's very much involved in the writing of the script and the...
Did many things go wrong on that sequence? Because looking at it, I mean, you've got guys on motorbikes and going down bobsleigh runs. I mean, there must have been a few.
We had someone killed in the picture.
Really?
On that sequence.
Yeah.
But it wasn't someone who was a stunt man or a special man that we brought in. It was, you know, the Cortina run is very dangerous. There have been many people killed in different over the years there. It's notorious in the bobsledding world. So we were reluctant to take anyone in who was not to ride a bobsled, who was not very experienced. So we used the local team that uses it all the time.
Yeah.
And one of their men, it was a freak accident, one of their men was killed. It was a terrible tragedy.
If we could concentrate now on Octopussy, is it going to be, if you like, in the same mould as Moonraker, i.e. an epic, or will it be like For Your Eyes Only, a more of a thriller?
It's extravagant, and it's a thriller both. I think it's more exotic. That's the best way to put it. We have a band of women smugglers. Very exotic ladies.
Yeah.
They have very exotic costumes, they do very exotic things, they're very athletic, they're all super athletes. And in fact, we've put together a team of women who's headed up by Susan Dando, who is the was the team captain to the last Olympics for the British gymnastic team. And she has put together all these ladies who are gymnasts and dancers and that.
I see. Now, the set we're on at the moment is a rather elaborate dining room. What actually takes place here? Is this the home of the baddies?
Yes, this is the home of the baddie, played by Louis Jordan.
Yeah.
And we see here, well, if you see behind me, this is the entry hall. And if you have a chance to look up there, you'll see that those are all practical sets. All the rooms go into other rooms.
Really?
There's a set, suites of rooms all back there, and it's double clad, which means the outside of the set is also built, because Bond has to climb along the windows outside. So we film, it's a very, very elaborate set,
built a lot
more realistically than sets normally would be built.
So, for example, would the camera track up the stairs and into the room? And
well, we find, we're all up here, we're there. We use the whole set as if we're up. It's built more like a real location would be built than a film set.
You said Louis Jordan is the Octopussy villain. What kind of a bad guy is he? Is he in the mold of Blofeld or Drax, or is he a new breed of super criminal?
Well, I think you can imagine Louis Jordan as being a very smooth villain, and yet a very sinister villain. I think he's working very well. He's an excellent actor, and this type of role is perfect for him.
Can we expect any new and wonderful gadgets on this picture?
Well, we have our gadgets. I think that it's the usual stock of sort of exotic gadgets. I hate to give away any right now.
Yes.
Because they're type of thing that are little surprises in the picture. But I don't think the people would be disappointed who are looking for the gadgets. On the other hand, I think we felt we were getting probably too gimmicky.
Mm.
I think an important thing about the gadgets that we use, you have to, in order for the gadget to work and be convincing, you have to have it be sort of a general purpose item used, and not a very, very specific thing that could only happen in one possible situation. And that may takes a little more effort to
think of
those things, but I think that's the only way they can be convincing. So I always try, I think that's people, to the extent that people feel offended by the gadgets, I think that they feel it's a little too set up. So I always try to keep them sort of general and make it very unclear as to how this is going to be useful. And
so is it you who actually dreams up these new gadgets?
Well, I think I couldn't take all the credit for it. I mean, I have my share. But the special effects people, the art department, they're very helpful. They come up with a lot of good ideas.
Now, what is the future of the James Bond movie? Do you think you're going to do 3 or 4, or do you think you've gone as far as you can with them?
We have a very rough democracy in our business. And about every 2 years, everybody goes to the cinema and votes on whether we get put back in office or not. So we just have to see how good we can make the films and hope that the people want to keep on seeing them.
Do you think that Roger Moore is going to come back and play the next James Bond?
He said he's said several times that he's not going to do it.
Again,
I don't know. You know, we've had little tussles from time to time about his coming back in the pictures.
But if you did pick a new Bond, would he have to be British?
We'd certainly prefer that he be British.
Yeah. Now, there's talk in the paper that Lewis Collins is the next James Bond after his performance in Who Dares Wins. What would you say to that?
Well, what I saw from what I read in the newspaper, he said that he's made
Bond.
And I think probably many people do agree with him. I've met him several times.
Never
I think
trust
he's a good actor.
Now, a subject which is receiving a lot of attention in the British media at the moment is video piracy. And I believe I'm correct in saying that even before Prince Charles saw For Your Eyes Only, a video pirate copy was available in a central London store. What are your own production team, Eon Productions, doing to combat this next summer?
We have a motion picture association here that is fighting this, and the people who are most interested in stamping it out are the people that release and distribute legitimate cassette tapes. And they are working very diligently. I think people probably don't understand the area too well.
Mm.
A copy of a film that has not yet been released, like I understand there's some copies of E.T. available right now.
Quite a number.
That's called a bootleg. That is somebody who has actually taken a transfer off the original film, or just shot a TV camera in the cinema as the film's going.
I get you, yeah.
Those tend to be pretty poor copies. They can be widely distributed, and they're certainly one of the most irritating forms of piracy, because people are there sort of getting a look at your picture and they see it in a really terrible way. So it really, I think, is very damaging.
Yeah.
Not only does it take people away from the box office in the future, but it also kind of gives people a poor impression of your product. So I think it's sort of irritating from two points of view. The second thing is what we call a pirate copy. And those are copies of cassette tapes of things that have either been shown on television and taped off the air, or they're tapes that are available in the marketplace for rent or to buy, and those are copied. they tend, too, to be lower quality and of some. I suppose they account for approximately 20% of the cassette business in this country. The third thing is called a counterfeit, and I think that that's probably one of the most insidious forms of piracy, because If you were to see a pirated tape, you could not distinguish it. The artwork is just the same. The inside of the cassette is the same quality. It has all the labels on it. And you have no idea that you're involved in using a pirated copy. They're sold in the high street stores. They're rented out on the high street. People can very well go along and want to be law-abiding and want to make sure that they're doing the right thing, and yet they're taking one of these things and not even knowing it. The money that they're spending is not in no way going back to the producers to help him make new films.
So when you say that this third category is very realistic to the original copy, this must mean that the pirates, if I can call them that, must have had access to the original print.
Well, they at least had access to the they might have had access to the master, or they might have made a very high quality transfer from a tape that was in the marketplace, which is possible too. The point about it is that in order to do this, you have to have a lot of money. You have to have it all printed. You have to put a lot of money invested in tapes. This accounts for about 30% of the entire cassette business, these counterfeit tapes. And it's run by organized crime on a wide scale. They deal in thousands and thousands of units of each film. And that is a very harmful effect on our business. I think you have to understand, too, that based on the forecasts of next year, the cassette rental business in the retail rental, the volume will exceed the cinema admission prices in this country.
Yeah.
So that we are entering an era when cassette tapes business exceeds the cinema business. I think that this is potentially harmful because it means that the market is not large format cinemas where the product is shown in its best light and high quality. Therefore, producers may feel that it's not necessary to spend all the money we do. I mean, it costs, right now, it costs about, our pictures run about 1,500 pounds per foot, how much they cost. And in order to it's a high cost, but we have a high technically high quality product. If we are to only be showing these things on in television sets, people will say, well, why are you spending all that money for? And if I could see it in this country, that it would, you know, in 10 years you may find that cinema business only accounts for 10% of them.
Okay, Michael Wilson, good luck with Octopussy and with the future, and thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pleasure.